Hello and welcome to Design Chat, the best live design discussion on the internet. I'm your host, Ryan McGovern. On Twitter, I'm at Hoopajube and at Design Chat. Every week, we get together with some of the coolest people from the design community and just share our experiences, right? You can ask questions. It's like a little design conference every single week. You can get together with very awesome people and just converse and live and talk about ideas, right? So this week, we are talking to Joshua Smith, a.k.a. Hydro74. Welcome, Joshua Smith. Golf clap. What's going on, man? How are you?
Yeah.
Good. How are you?
Fantastical. Yeah. Fantastical. Freezing my butt off in Chicago. It's like 6 degrees today. But you're down in Orlando. Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah.
Sweet. Yeah. Sweet. Jealous. I'm very jealous.
No, it's actually in the 40s right now.
Oh, ho-hum, 40s. I could go outside without a jacket in that weather. Are you kidding me? All right, so here's how it goes down. We've got an hour. We're going to do a little bit of get-to-know-you session. Then we're going to take questions from the audience. And if you've never been here before, you can do that in two ways, audience. There's a little light bulb icon right there. You can click on that, and you can submit a question. That's either in text form, so you type it in, or if you've got a webcam, you can actually sort of write a summary of what you're going to ask, and you can come on camera and sort of be face-to-face. So please, please, I encourage you guys to do that, participate in the design community. Okay, all right, let's kick it off. Joshua, let's get a little bit of your backstory. Let's hear a little bit about where you started in art and your creative life and how you got rolling.
That's a very long question. I guess
we got time, buddy.
I'm a college dropout and just decided to learn everything on my own. I actually went for elementary ed and just kind of see where it went, and had some issues with the people that were running the education department. So I got bitter and pretty pissed off. So I just did liberal arts, took some painting and drawing classes, and professor was doing visual communications, a new class, so I decided to jump in on it. There's nothing like learning Photoshop at the same time as professor, but, you know, it's all good. And so after about a couple years of that, I decided to drop out. This wasn't worth the price I was paying, so decided to just stick with it and learn. And it just took 5 or 6 years of just busting my butt trying to figure out the software, and I was able to do it. So
it's one of those stories that, you know, in a way, you talk to a lot of your friends about how you come up and what your path was to get to where you are. It's a story. It seems like a common thread, right? There's, you know, a number of things that a lot of people try sometimes before we discover design or illustration or what really, you know, gets us going. Did you have an inkling, like, at a younger age in high school or even grade school, that sort of art would be a career that you would actually pursue?
No. I hate to say it, but I always thought that graphic designers and artists were kind of like the janitorials of the world. It's like it was such a lesser degree, and I wanted to do something sophisticated. I wanted to have a tie every day and have a very prestigious job. And I mean, design, honestly, it was just, I was pissed off, and it clicked. And I mean, after I started getting freelance gigs, I started liking them. Like $500 to do an illustration, that's weird. So I just kind of stuck with it. But no, I never really wanted to be a designer. It was just one of those things where I just have ADD and I like to draw a lot. But I mean, we're talking like horrible, like little doodles and having like little army men play war with each other. And I actually just wanted to do something kind of prolific as far as more white collar, high end. And I'm actually very thankful I didn't take that route, because I'm actually enjoying the fact that I can do my own thing right now.
Why do you think there is that misconception, so many different misconceptions about the art and creative world and how that translates into professionalism?
I graduated from high school in 94, and I dropped out of college around like 99, give or take, after a year off. And during that time, like, it was, visual arts was actually just starting. Like, Mike Cena or Chena, however you pronounce it, from York for them, he was getting online, and I actually got in touch with Joshua Davis, and he helped me out with some pirated software. just for learning purposes.
Awesome.
But I mean, it was good because, you know, being a poor guy from South Bend, Indiana, I mean, I would never afford any of the Adobe stuff. And, you know, I had, like, just a very generic computer, which I think about a month later got infected by viruses. So, actually, that pirated stuff wasn't really that big of a deal. I'd actually gone and steal it from my professors. But, during that time, it's like the graphic design studios, especially in the Midwest, are they're extremely lame. It's like you're doing newspaper layouts and clunky ads for local dealerships. And, I mean, there wasn't really any prestige to it. And I think it was probably around, like, 2002 when you started really noticing the big boom, especially on the Internet. And I was thankful that I was doing stuff a little bit beforehand, because then you start seeing a lot of prolific people just, like, come up out of nowhere. Like, I remember that was the first time I saw, like, Surf Station, and that was a brilliant site. And I remember Thomas Rodell asked me to supply him some, Photoshop brushes. So I sent those over, and they're pretty successful. And it was just kind of fun seeing that stuff everywhere. And then I started playing with a photographer, because I was working at this really crappy agency up in Grand Rapids, Michigan. So I started just toying around with that, made a couple of really bad fonts and stuck them out there. And I mean, it was just kind of fun as it started snowballing. And but as far as all that aesthetic goes, it's just, during that time, I don't think there was any prestige in it, where now it seems like everybody wants to be a designer. It's almost like the easy way out. It's like you have all these graphic design students coming out of school, and it's like they just, I hate to say it, but they don't really know their from a hole in the ground, just because they assume that they're going to get out of college and make this like $50,000 to $60,000 job. And people that are seasoned are like, yeah, it's like I started out like at 15, you know. And I mean, it's a very difficult thing. You have to climb those ropes. And so it's like this instant ego. And all these people come out of school now thinking that they're like, I mean, it gets really annoying after a while. And honestly, at the end of the day, it's just I think the reality sets into most who do the freelance, where we kind of respect the fact that corporate stuff is really lame, and a lot of the progressive stuff is really lame, because it's all based on sales and based on trends. And when you have that comfortability to be able to do that, but also be able to be a little bit more creative and be able to do your own thing on top of that, it actually makes it a little bit more interesting, which was something I wasn't really privy to when I first started out. I mean, honestly, my first glimpses was opening up the South Bend Tribune or the Chicago Times or whatever it was, and just looking through, I'm like, oh, that's a cool ad, you know, and going to Barnes & Noble and checking out magazine design, which really wasn't that great at the time. I mean, it was done in Quark and very limited as far as, like, technique. So, I mean, it just wasn't enticing at the time. But it was just one of those things where I didn't want to work in a factory. And coming from the Midwest, I mean, your options are pretty limited. You're either going to be a teacher or you're going to work in a factory. So I decided, since teaching obviously wasn't down my path, I'm going to do design, because I didn't want to work in a factory. I did that many, many times. So.
Right. So you're born in the Midwest. You came full circle, and it worked out great. You're born in the Midwest. You're coming up, and you're starting to get a couple of your first jobs. You said you worked at a small agency or something like that. What made you take the jump to move to Florida? And I ask this only because, you know, I think we're finding out more and more in this, you know, golden age of the, you know, internet. You know, if you've got talent and a computer and an internet connection, you can work in anywhere in the entire world and still be able to have plenty of connections and plenty of good communication.
Yeah, I mean, it's as far as the internet question, I mean, I live and die off of it. Like, when a media tempo goes down, I just want to go over there and Falcon punch them in the nuts, because it's part of my business. And when that goes down, it's just really annoying. But for the most part, when I first started out, I got a couple freelance jobs. One was with BEC Records, Tooth and Nail, whatever. We did this, like, little site in the side, and the owner, Brandon, liked it, so he contacted me for this really horrible illustration of just Japanese animation stuff. So in college, I got, like, you know, $500 check and a bunch of CDs. I mean, that was awesome. And then this drum and bass label out of New York, which died, Mutant something, they had me do some Japanese anime-looking things. Horrible as well. And, you know, that was like another $300. I mean, that was really fun. And it wasn't until probably 2000 that I took the jump to work over in Grand Rapids, Michigan at the skateboard company called Stink Brand. It was also part of a silkscreen company called Studio Inc. And they were doing all the stuff for House Industries at the time. They had one of the sign writers was Bill Danforth, and that guy is rad. I mean, he's just he's an old Hessian guy. Love it. And so that was like my first baptism by fire design job. I mean, I was just doing like website graphics, nothing exciting, but it was still being able to work with these guys because they were really, really awesome. And you start learning all those like techniques. I mean, especially when you see the Ruby lifts that are coming in from Coop, and you're like, okay, so that's not digital. He actually cut those out with a X-Acto knife, and you know, seeing the production on it, and then going back to the warehouse and seeing all the Ratfink stuff that they're printing up. They're doing like these these like iron-on transfers for one of his releases, and then we had access to all the House Industry fonts. I mean, that was awesome. I mean, granted, I was probably making like $26,000, so I mean, it wasn't like a a money job by any means. And then after that, I ended up moving to. Well, actually, I worked for a small agency called Barfus Creative. It was horrible. And then ended up moving to Dayton, Ohio, and I worked with Access Media, and that's where I got in with the guys that worked on all the BMX stuff, like DK, who else, Giant, Eastern Bikes, and then I remember going out to lunch with Chris Carter. Chris Carter, he's the owner of Alien Workshop, with Steve Bundeck, who's like a really high-profile photographer for Ride Magazine. And him and Corey were just awesome. They taught me a lot of stuff. I mean, I was still really rookie at it, and it was just fun. I got to do all these illustrations, and it was fun going over to DK over in, at the time they're in Franklin, I think they moved, but going over there and hanging out with them, and just kind of getting like the heritage and history on BMX. And what happened was, after a year living in Dayton, Ohio, and you probably know as much as I do, the Midwest is horrible weather-wise. It's like, you can only handle so many days of this gray skies before you get really affected by just the weather. And the fact that we had really no friends when we were living in Dayton, both Axis and I just come to an agreement. We're like, I obviously want to pursue bigger things. And on the same token, it's just, I wasn't fitting in there because I was just really bitter from the weather. Mm-hmm. I love the guys, but it was just really hard to come into work every day under gray, miserable weather. And not only that, but Dayton, Ohio is kind of like Gary, Indiana. I mean, it's not fun by any means. And so after that, I got a call up from this magazine here in Florida. I'm not going to mention its name because I really hate it. And so I started working there for like a short bit. And probably after like 3 years, or about a year and a half, I went to creative director. And creative director was basically, yeah, you work at 40, but we also need 20 extra hours from you to creative direct everybody else. And he would just hire in like the weakest talent, and you had to basically train him and everything. And it just got really old, because when you work with a boss who is, he's just schizophrenic. One moment he's like, it's approved. And the next day you're like, yeah, I didn't approve that. You're like, you mother, you know, it's just, it got really, really annoying. So after about 3.5 years of working for him, I just decided to make the choice. It's like, it's either freelance and take that stab, make that step, because I had about 3 months worth of income saved up. I'm like, I got 3 months to see if I can make it. And it worked. I mean, it was really successful. I mean, so I was able to make that jump, and I still live my life by the 3 to 6 month plan. If I get to a point where the 3 or 4 months are not coming in financially strong, then that's kind of an indicator for me to actually look for another job. But so far, everything's been awesome. So it's like, you know, we've been able to take care of everything, and that's kind of where I kind of got to this point. So, and I've been doing this since like freelance for like the last 4 years, 5 years, full time. So
it sounds like early on you had a lot of good connections in a way, either by, you know, just by paying attention to what was around you, or by reaching out to work and collaborate and be around the people that you wanted to be around. What was the motivation for that? How did you, like, did you know inherently right away, if I'm going to come up and be successful, I need to reach out to those people? Or was it, you know, sort of happenstance also?
No, I mean, when I got the job in Grand Rapids at the skateboard company, it was kind of a funny story. There was a gay guy that worked with him, and he found me hot, so he wanted me to actually work there so he could have a chance with me, which I was like, yeah, it's not happening. And but, I mean, it was a good introduction. I mean, I'm not going to complain one bit. And then what happened was, I think it was the one in Dayton, Ohio, Axis. I had a portfolio online. I forgot what it was. It was kind of like a crop site. Oh, no, it was Coral Flot. Yeah, that's what it was. They saw my work on there, and then they sent me up and asked me, it's like, yeah, you want to come down here to work with us? And I was like, yeah, I mean, of course. So that one was a little bit less sexually motivated, which is nice. But I mean, those connections were there. But on the same token, the one thing I kind of started when I first got into legitimate design is I just started setting goals. And my goals are really simple at the time. Like, my first goal was, like, I want to do a CD layout. You know, just that was just my first, like, project I want to do. And lo and behold, that was, like, the first project I actually got that was kind of official. I mean, granted, it's like I never would wish that on anybody. I mean, CD design is really, really annoyingly hard. And so after that, it's like I just made my things. Like, I want to make a T-shirt. And we ended up doing some T-shirts for some friends. And I was like, well, I want to work in the progressive industry. I want to work for, like, more of the action sports brands. So I just started focusing my work a little bit more on that. So my next goal is actually work for them. And I think that's my first legitimate gig was from Split back in the day, back when they're actually doing really well. I think they're owned by another company now. But and actually, the guy I met through there, we're still friends, and he works at another company right now. But it's like we still talk, and we always hang out whenever I get out to Costa Mesa. But I just kept setting goals, like, on things I want to accomplish. And if you don't have these goals, you'll never really reach it. And it's like I never really had, like, a game plan. Like, yeah, I'm going to be, like, the best designer out there. I could honestly give a about that. But to me, it's like I just want to set goals because they were just personal goals. They weren't trying to, you know, make everybody else happy. It was just to make me happy. I just wanted to find where I could possibly go. And I guess the best example were two things that happened about a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago, was I remember checking out a friend of mine over at I Love Dust in the UK, and I noticed that they're doing some packaging for Levi's. Excuse me. And my first thought was like, man, I'd really love to work for Levi's. I mean, that seems like they're a really legitimate company, and it seems like they really take a good step in providing for their freelancers. They seem like a pretty fair company as far as everything that I read. And they also did, like, the packaging design for the box. They did the shirts and everything. And probably about a month later, they ended up contacting me. And the funny thing was, it was the European Levi's. So I just found that odd that I set this goal. I never really told anybody about it, and they contacted me. And the same thing happened with Target. I think it was about a year and a half, 2 years ago. I just always wanted to work for Target. And I think it was a very minimal goal. Yeah. But it was just one of those things where it's like, I would love to get their attention. And it's almost like this whole karma-ish kind of aspect. But they ended up, like, contacting me. And it wasn't, like, through a firm or through a third-party system. It was directly from Target. And met this guy, Will, and did some racing stuff. I don't even know if I actually did anything out there with it, but I mean, it turned out nice. But it was just kind of funny where it's like when you mentally set goals and when you physically set goals, your career is going to go much further than what it will. And the thing is, too, it's like if you don't have a sense of patience, you're not going to reach it because everybody has, like, this whole Americanized, like, we need it now and we got to be the best now and we need to copy this and make this. And it's like, it's just, you got to be patient. If you're not patient, then you're going to be a total failure and you're going to be a has-been within a few years. And I mean, not that that's something I care about with my career. I mean, if I become a has-been, I don't care. It's like, as long as I'm still doing what I love, I'm happy about that. But if you don't set those goals and have a sense of patience with it, then you're really not going to ever accomplish it. And so that's kind of where my mentality came from. And that's been pretty much my mantra for, like, the last, like, 7-8 years is it's just I want to set these goals that are realistic. I mean, one was financially, two was projects, three was just way of living. And I mean, granted, it's like you definitely have your failures. I mean, it's kind of obvious with, you know, life in general. But on the same part, if you don't have these goals, then you'll never see accomplishments. And to me, that's where it came in. Is like I just want to see these accomplishments. And when these things do come in, it was brilliant. I loved it.
So it seemed like very early on, as soon as online portfolios existed, your work was being spread across the internet. And I want to talk a little bit about personal branding. I want to talk a little bit about representing yourself online and how to do that. And it seems like it's getting a little bit easier to do now that there's so many, like, portfolio tools out there, and it's just so much easier to talk and share things now. And of course, it always helps really if your work is... It is getting convoluted, but it also helps if your work is sick, like yours is, because people want to see that, and content is king. So I just want to get your thoughts on your state, your personal state of personal branding, and what you think are good habits to have for creatives right now.
That's a pretty subjective question. I mean, it's kind of like one of those to each their own sort of situations. I mean, what works for one person is not going to work for the other. And so if you set these guidelines where if you tell a new freelancer coming to an industry, it's like you need to go A, B, and C, and they don't have the same success, I mean, it's going to be horrible for them. So, I mean, it's a learning process. I mean, if you don't have the defeats, then you're never going to have the successes. And so for me personally, it's like I never really branded myself. I mean, it's just I came up with, like, this little scripty logo a while back. People liked it. And I was like, oh, cool. And so, I mean, and when I started doing pieces, I started realizing the clients aren't they don't have ownership of my work. It's like, I don't sign away ownership unless it's for a really good dollar amount, just because it doesn't make any sense. It's like, there, it's basically a usage. You know, I'm licensing. But on the same token, I'm going to be really legitimate with them, and I'm not going to reuse it to somebody else or use it to somebody else in the same demographic by any means. But I can actually chip away these elements, and that's where it's like little skull logo of mine kind of came to effect. Like, I decided to start dropping that into pieces, and it was crazy. Like, I think I did a shirt for Nike a while back, and I had my little skull logo on there. I'm like, maybe I shouldn't be so blatant with it, but I mean, it was like this design aesthetic, and so to me, it was just like my little subtlety. It's like, you don't always need like a signature, but I mean, like I said, it's like, this is a very subjective question, so I mean, you can ask like 10 people the same question, you're going to get totally different answers, just because people have the version that was taught to them by the professors, people have what was taught to them by really their favorite designer, if you will. Then you have just the methods of people who just learned it on their own. So, I mean, really all it is, and this is my formula, is you just have to be legitimate with people. You have to be honest with people and trap the ego. I mean, seriously, it's like all of us designers, we're in the same boat. It's like no one really cares about designers. You talk to anybody that actually works in a marketing firm or in like some major firm, it's like designers, we have a little office in the back space and no one really cares. And so it's like when we have all that infighting amongst ourselves, it's like, and then you have people who are like thinking that they're like the best of the best and other people who are struggling that could use the help from those that have the best of the best. It's like you're only hurting your department. You're only hurting the success of each other. And so when you have that infighting, it's like that's basically the virus that kills legitimate designers. And so with that, it's like I just try to go about it. It's like online, like on Twitter, occasionally I like throw out like the little egotistical thing, but it's just, I mean, I hate to say it, but it's just f-ing giggles, and if people take me seriously, I'm sorry, but I mean, it's just me. It's like this way I can vent just for the fun of it. But on the same token, it's just whenever I try to talk to somebody, like a good example, I just did a gallery show in Memphis with Revolt Marketing and Flat 50, Lyra, and a few other companies. And during the whole thing, it's like we purposely made it so we could, one, communicate a very authentic approach with these people. And because Memphis is a very struggling city, and so it's like, you know, these people are going to be coming in with like hundreds of dollars, be able to spend, you know, all this like crazy stuff that you have for sale. So I mean, we're giving away shoes, we're giving away decks, we're giving away posters left and right. And we saw someone that was like truly in need. We actually did something nice for him. And I remember these like really gangster ghetto kids that came in. I mean, they're kind of scary at first, but after talking to them, the kid was like, man, I want to be a designer. I'm like, awesome. Well, here's my email. It's like, put stuff online. Show me. It's like, if your stuff's awesome, I'll hire you out and do something with you. And then I'll promote you. And to me, it's like, that is the core essential of designers. I mean, we can talk the game, but
I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you said that. And here's why. Sorry, hold on. Here's why. Because at Laren's just tweeted, been fascinated by Hydro74's work since high school. Watching him on Design Chat right now. Turns out he's a real dude. Okay, basically, like, relevant to the same story you just told, once we finally get in a room with each other and we're talking, right, and we're sharing our ideas, all of a sudden, you know, the preconceived notions we might have had about a person or a person in a certain profession is totally gone, and work can happen, collaboration can happen. So what on the idea of that, I want to ask you about collaboration. I want to ask you about how some of your relationships form, and if you reach out for them, and how, what's the process that you go through when you collaborate doing work with someone?
It's kind of weird because when people come to me, at least clients, they tend to want my style, which I still haven't really figured out. Everybody says I have a style, and I really strongly disagree. But there are times when I see people like my good friend Zombie Eddie. we went to junior high together, and I remember actually in art class winning more awards than him, and he was like way better than I was, so I was able to rub it in his face. But after years, we end up reconnecting, and the guy, he was doing web design, and you could tell he hated his job. And I was like, just sketch up a skull for me. I'm going to send it over to like Hart and Huntington to see if they like it or whatever. And like he did it, and I was like, why are you not doing this? Why are you not doing this on, you know, much more? And so I just really encouraged him to like take that step out. And so I started working with him a lot more. And I worked with Troy White back in the day, T. White Design. Like, the guy is really amazingly talented and really one of the most sincere guys I've ever really worked with. I mean, we had like a little bit of an outing just because of like some really minor issues, but it's just because I get moody at times, you know, I'll admit it. It's like, I'm not perfect. And so, but on the same token, it's like that has nothing to do with our relationship. Like, you guys are still fantastic designer. And so and I collaborate with people. Like, I get a lot of requests, and to me, it's like, I would love to be honest. And but the thing is, like, it's just a time factor. And so I think what I'm probably going to do, like, in January or February, I might just put together, like, a big sheet of vectors and just, like, say, okay, we're just going to take a couple stabs at it and basically try to get, like, four or five people into it. And then, you know, just try to keep it, like, one or two color. And then at the end of the day, we'll just print them up. We'll split the run. I'll give them 50 that you can sell. And, I mean, if it helps promote them and they have some, like, legitimate talent, not the, you know, look what I copied out of Dover and threw some DaFont type on top of. I mean, as long as they have a little bit of, like, characteristic and skill, it's why not? Why not promote those people? And to me, it's like, that's what it's about. It's like, you know, until you actually walk or talk to somebody and actually have the ability to communicate a little bit with somebody, you find out it's a different person behind their alias. And it's really rad because then you have people that you can call up in the middle of the night, like my friend Fulton over at Salvation Army. It's like, I'll call him up. And I mean, it's nice that we can have a very serious conversation. And but we still collab, but we can also be very sincere and honest with one another. And to me, it's like, that's the one thing that I actually do enjoy, because when you work independently, if you don't have those connections, I think I just kind of, like, went around in a big circle here, but yeah, I like collaborations, just don't have time for them.
Speaking of collaboration and reaching out to people, let's do that right now. We got lots of questions rolling in. I'm very excited about that. So we're going to take our first question of the night from Dave Brenner, who wants to know, Hydro, can you take us through your process in Illustrator? Do you make your own brushes, etc.? So I knew this was going to be a question that came up tonight, because a lot of people, you know, are going to be curious about how you get to your end result, right? So just give us a little glance into your illustration world.
I basically have these people over in China. I've been promising them their independence here to America if they keep doing work for me. And so I send over to these kids in China. No, I don't use brushes. I don't use any shortcuts. I mean, the only time I use brushes is if I, like, stroke something out. It's just basically I use a mouse, I use a tablet. I mean, here you can, it's my setup. Nothing overly exciting. But it's like I don't use a Wacom tablet or anything like that, or Wacom, or however you pronounce it. By the way, whenever they name that company, why'd they name it where it's so confusing? Is it Wacom, Wacom? Anyway, I just start, and usually sometimes I cheat and I use, like, some reference Google. I go into Photoshop and I splice it together into how the shape I kind of want it to be, because you always need that core foundation. You always need – it's almost like Norman Rockwell. It's like you always have references all over the place. And to me, that's what I do. Mm-hmm. It's like, if I'm maybe drawing a lion as an example, it's like, yeah, I'm going to find a bunch of lions, and I'm going to also find, like, one where I can kind of Photoshop it together and kind of make it where it's like the perspective is there, because perspective is key. And so, I'll go around there, just do, like, a really rough kind of outline, just kind of know where things are supposed to be. Then I just delete that image and then start going in and allow myself to be creative, because I noticed a long time ago, if I was relying strictly on the photo, it was just a horrible. And so to me, it's like, just know where the perspectives are, and then you start clicking away, allow yourself to be creative. And then you start realizing that these chains are kind of lifted as far as, becoming a over-glorified tracer, or to a actual person that's being creative. And so that's kind of what I did. I just go in there and I start detailing out all the lines, and basically it's just click, 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 click. I mean, but I've just gotten so fast at it where it sounds a little bit faster than that. Click, 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 maybe. I don't know. So yeah, I don't really use brushes or anything. So, and occasionally, and if you want to, it's like I was just going to say, I use a Ustream once in a while to show my process. I think we had, like, you know, like, I had, like, maybe 20 people watching one day. So.
Oh, that's cool.
They were bored.
Well, I don't think that's boring at all. I think, you know, with a little bit of the right seating, like, you could get crazy amounts of people who are going to want to watch that. That'd be really awesome. In fact, we should do that. We should do that sometime in the future, you know, do another design chat and, like, set up like, ahead of time a sort of reference or a project that you have going on, and we can take the whole audience. I mean, we got 75 people right now, and I barely promoted this thing at all. You know, we just kind of threw it on Twitter.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Well, that's just kind of how we roll at Design Chat, right? It's just sometimes, it's just kind of how it happens. And it's an organic thing, and it's fun for us.
Set the noise. He's awesome. We got to have him. Hydro, yeah, he's coming.
Oh,
man. James is awesome. We love James White. He's the man.
I do. I'm joking.
Dan Shapiro, let's see if we can bring him on. He was at a lot of our shows early on. Dan, how you doing?
Hey, what's going on?
Welcome back, buddy. You got a question for Josh? Am I coming through?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, I do. Senior Hydro. How did the Golden Blacks start?
That's all Chris Parks. We were talking one day, and I threw out the idea. It's like, once you start doing this, and he did. So that's his baby. I just threw up some fonts.
Yeah.
It's a design resource site. So nothing overly exciting, you know.
No.
Cool, Dan. Well,
sorry,
Dan,
big fan of your work. Dan.
Dan.
Thank you.
Dan's a guy
it.
Who. Yep. See you, Dan. He was part of our, participating in our show very early on. He's a young design student. He just started his first semester, so he wasn't able to participate for the whole semester because he had classes on Wednesday night, so it's very exciting to see him come back. Dan, the man.
I think he had me up a while back. I think we've been in communication. Right, Dan? I don't know. Maybe.
Dan's good peeps, for sure. Next question we're taking here is from Clean Sweep 13. Wants to know, what are some of your favorite typography designers? I love your cholo and tattoo hand styles.
That's kind of a hard one because, I have so many books and there's so many people out there that do typography. I was definitely heavily influenced when the whole 909 thing came out. Like, I think it was like my friend Max 242, super rad guy, he started showing me all this stuff. They started like introducing me to all the guys over at Tribal Gear, and Bobby from there, who's the owner, he started pointing me out to all these different guys. I think it was like Monk One and I forgot some of the other guys' names. This influencing me on that, and I got to a point where I'd actually kind of pull back because when I went over to Tribal Gear, they were calling me like the honorary Latino, and I was like, it's like, you know, that it's funny, but you know, on the same token, it was just kind of like, yeah, I'm a pasty white guy, I know, but it's definitely a lot of fun. But I've started getting more into the classical stuff, and I don't even know who the typographers are, but old whiskey labels, old wine labels, old cigar labels, typography on old currency. Like some of the typography on the old Russian rubles from like back in the 30s and 40s. Oh my God, stuff was lush. And you start looking at that stuff, then like obviously letterhead fonts, they've been doing a lot to highlight a lot of this more kind of like antique-ish sort of turn of century kind of vibe. And then also too, I had this book and somebody stole it from me. I can't find it anymore, but it was like this complete like Herb Lubin, I think his name, basically showed all of his works, and that was like a major factor, especially about 3 or 4 years ago, to see what, you know, he was able to do with like avant-garde and Lubin script and was it like Sarah Gothic and things like that. I mean, it was pretty amazing. So I mean, yeah, there's not really any one typographer. It's just it kind of goes on whim. Like one moment you like something, next moment you don't, you know.
We're going to bring our next caller. Mr. James White is joining us.
Hey, all right, cool.
James White!
Thanks for having me on. Hey, Josh Smith is here. Yay! It was so funny. We were setting up the camera a couple seconds ago. At the second, I was like, did he just say my name? So I looked about just half of that sentence, whatever the hell you said.
I think he was making fun of me for my bad promotion job.
Yep. He likes you more than me. So.
Dude, I was doing my best trying to get your name out there, man. I was so stoked, man. Josh, cool. Thanks for doing this, man. This is awesome. I've been kind of waiting to see you do an interview like this online for a while, man. I'm like a huge fan. I'm wearing your shirt. Check it out. I'm like the guy that shows up at the rock concert wearing the band shirt of who's playing.
The band of their show, yeah.
So
I always wear the wrong band. Oh, yeah. Here's my Limp Bizkit shirt of the Korn show. Yeah. Go, guys. Bad example. I don't listen to
them. My question is actually related. Sure, yeah. My question is actually related. To this shirt, actually. And I wanted to ask you this a while ago. And if you want to talk about it, that is, if the government doesn't show up with helicopters. But I just wanted to ask you about if you could talk about the Masonic kind of imagery that you put into a lot of your works. I notice you have a lot of kind of Freemason stuff and a lot of pyramids with eyes and the all-seeing thing. And is that something you want to discuss?
I was always intrigued by the Masonic stuff. I mean, just growing up back in a day where I come from an extremely poor family, and the fact that we were on and off welfare and just going into like all these government buildings and even foster care and stuff like that, you start seeing like all these little things. And I remember like seeing the Eye of Providence when I was younger. I'm like, that's kind of rad that I know it's on the back of a dollar bill. And so I mean, it was definitely intriguing. I never really knew the history on it, and the whole Masonic thing was just I just liked the way it looked, and so I started like just toying around with it. And the brass tacks thing, it's not anything overly serious. I just print up like a few shirts here and there, so I'm not trying to go like global, large scale on it. It's just more of a kind of tongue-in-cheek sort of a little thing, just an outlet for me to do my own thing. But I just want to kind of do like this whole secret society, and it's kind of funny because I put it out there and people get all like bent out of shapes, like Illuminati. I'm like, all right, cool, and so it's like it's just funny because everybody has their own perspective. You have the conspiracy theorists, you have the realists, and you have the people that are on the total right side who definitely are in their own little world. And so it's, you get all these different perspectives. But as far as design elements, there's just something about it that's just fascinating. And I mean, honestly, too, it's definitely a trend thing. I mean, I think even Jay-Z put out like a little Masonic label not too long ago. And I was just joking with a friend of mine. I'm like, yeah, he's ripping me off. He's ripping me off. Anyway, but yeah, it was just kind of funny. So I mean, it's definitely a trend thing. And I mean, it's not anything I'm like, rock solid on. It's just kind of fun to do,
Yeah, it's got a little bit of mysterious.
And I can't really say anything more.
And it did become popular, because it was used in a number of movies. I think it was talked about in American Treasure, the Nicolas Cage movie where he's going all around the U.S. and all that kind of BS. But that's a good subject to tap into. The idea about tapping into something that's on the minds of the culture right now and using that to get the attention, to get your message across or show your art. Are there any other types of visual trends that you're seeing right now that you like or personally dislike?
Honestly, I haven't really been paying that much attention. I mean, not to be shrewd, but I get so inundated with work that my actual look online time is pretty much between looking at something funny, like I think it's like the pick of the day over at QBN, and tweeting it on Twitter. And so it's like I never really do much search on that. I know just recently I ran into this one guy. It's like Seldom Right, I think it is. I don't think it has like a legitimate website, but the guy's really talented. And then McBees, he's out of the UK, he's amazingly talented as well. And Cousin Dan, like I think he's out of the UK as well. Oliver Cram, I think it is. The guy's just amazingly talented. It's like this kind of hand-drawn, really detailed work. And it's beautifully done. It has kind of like the whole tattoo versus Masonic versus kind of like this kind of a high fructose kind of magazine-ish kind of vibe to it. And it's really fascinating. So, I mean, I can't really dictate as far as trends go. I mean, as far as where the movement's happening in the market right now, it's pretty much like this whole anti-UCF, or not UCF, but UFC kind of vibe. It's like people are kind of getting past the whole clip art thing. So if you're going to do clip art-ish, stuff in the background, make sure it's like kind of a little bit more elegant. I know, I hate to say it as much as of a fan I am, but I mean, obviously Obey's popping, RVCA's popping. Mike Giant, obviously, he's pretty brilliant with Rebel 8, him and Joshy D. And I mean, even like brands like Flat 50, it's like I start working with them, but I mean, the stuff that they're cranking out for all their clients, I get occasional sneak peek, and I'm like, that's actually pretty rad. So it's like when you start working with a few of the clients, you start kind of seeing where the trends are kind of coming from. But I mean, for me to pinpoint something, I can't. It's like I don't really pay that much attention to it, because it's definitely a battle. And usually the clients I work with, they kind of want what's done last year. So I mean, I'm not really having to always like fine tune every new thing. It's like I can still come up with my own little things, but in the same token, client work is pretty straightforward.
This question comes from our own Andrew Tibbetts, who helps us out with the show. Wants to know that he wants to let you know that he's used Revolution on many a band poster, and how should he send you money?
Preferably, I would rather him take the money and buy himself a beer with it. It's a free font. Enjoy.
Done and done. I think he's drinking one of these, the same as I am right now.
No, seriously, it's like if it's something I'm going for free, clip art or even the fonts on Legacy of Defeat. I mean, if it's a free one, use and abuse. And even too, it's if you buy one from me, there's no royalties. I mean, I don't believe in that crap. I mean, I'm not one of those guys who's trying to rape and pillage the wallets of people. I mean, if it's out there for free, use it. I mean, it's like, why do I need to police that crap? And so honestly, it's like if you download something to use and you make some money off of it, that's kind of the purpose, really, is kind of hoping that the design tool that I created might actually help you, you know? So yeah, it's like, especially in this economy, it's like, why pay me on something that you downloaded for free? You know, just it makes no sense to me. It's just it's kind of odd in a way, you know.
Next question here. There's no more live questions, guys. If you've got a video camera, please jump on. That would be awesome to see your faces. Daniel Catino wants you to talk about color palettes. Maybe you know how you go about choosing your color palettes for each one of your jobs.
Well, the rule of thumb that I learned from God Machine is when you prick your finger and you smear the blood out, you mix in different colors. I'm joking. Total joke. Now, color palettes, I mean, I don't know. A lot of the... No, it's, if you've ever seen God Machine's work, he's the guy, he's amazingly evil. Love him. Nice. But, I mean, color palettes, like, I mean, it's kind of hard because, I mean... Some things are in, some things are out, and honestly, I tend to like to work more in black and white and then let the either the in-house guys actually add color to it, or if I have to add color to it, then I try to just figure out what works. I mean, just kind of get a gauge on what's kind of selling, and I mean, the best way to do that is I'll go through like KarmaLoop.com or Moose Unlimited, which is another clothing site, and... excuse me, and just kind of like see kind of where everything's going at. And I mean, right now with the way the recession is, it's like everybody's just doing one color, maybe two color prints. And it's wise because it's cheaper. And so it's like you can minimize. So, I mean, I don't really spend a whole lot of time in that. I think there's a site that has like web color palettes. I forgot the name of, I can send out a link sometime, but or post on Twitter. But it's like that's a good site to follow, but just do what you like, I guess.
That's a good point that you brought up. You started to become successful and financially viable before, way before the economy went down. So what has changed for you professionally and in the way you work personally and with your clients in this down economy? What has changed your day to day?
Not much, really. Most of the clients that are coming back to me are ones I've already worked with, so we can be very candid with one another. And, like, I remember just recently working on, I think it was, like, Lucasfilms, and I was just joking with them, like, look, do you want more of this, like, you know, Ed Hardy bullshit? You want something a little bit different? And he's like, well, Ed Hardy's selling right now. I'm like, all right, I got it, you know? And so, I mean, it's just being candid and honest with them. And so, I mean, but in the same token, it's like, they're friends. They'll get your sense of humor and they'll understand you. But yeah, as far as like new clients, like the thing, I think the rule applies recession, non-recession is know your self-worth. If you don't know your self-worth, you're not going to be that successful. I mean, they're just going to basically try to barter you down like MTs. I hate MTs, not the site, but just the whole aura around it, because basically it's all these companies that are fishing there trying to take advantage of these really talented illustrators and trying to offer them up like, well, hey, $150 for this illustration that you spent like 10 hours on. And to me, it's like, no, the base rate on apparel is $300. Like that's industry standards for anything in the action sports. And that's what they should be paying. $500 for an illustration. Maybe $450, you can kind of like glow bomb a little bit. I mean, it's like if you're walking away with less than like $250 on an illustration, especially in this economy, it's like you need to find your self-worth. And so you have to kind of stand up to the stuff. And yeah. I mean, sometimes you can risk it, but the best advice I ever got was from John Cena, Mike Cena. Is that one, know your self-worth, and then two, you don't have to work on everything. It's like if a client doesn't want to pay you for something, spend that time when you're not working out for a client to actually do something for yourself. And if you're going to do something for yourself, make it worth something that you can actually sell later on. Create your elements, create your arsenal. And at the end of the day, like I took that to heart. I was like, yeah, if I'm not working on a client stuff and they're not willing to pay me for what it's worth, I'm going to design my own thing up. And then when the next project comes in, it's already done. So it's like, technically, it's like I have everything there. So it's like, you don't always have to sacrifice everything on it. I mean, it is a hard economy, but on the same token, it's just... You kind of have to stand up to what the worth is on the project if you're willing to allow go a little bit cheaper, then yeah, it's fine. But it's like, don't let these companies take advantage of you because the economy's still bad. They're still printing. They still have their budgets. So, I mean, at the end of the day, it's just, you know, you got to watch out for yourself because you're only working 10 times harder if you are selling for less.
Matt Beemans wants to know, how important do you think drawing skills are in this industry?
Nah, not that important, I guess. It depends on what you're working at. I mean, if you're going in there to be a production artist, why would you need drawing skills? Or if you're going in there to lay out T-shirts with, you know, the provided art and with elements around it, it's like you don't really need to know that stuff. I mean, some people are seasonally trained at drawing before they do illustrations. So to me, it's like, yeah, that's awesome. And if you want to spend the time doing the illustration before you actually go in there and do the illustration, then yeah, by all means, that's just, it's a technique. So, I mean, honestly, it's like, it's very subjective. I mean, it just depends what you're going into, you know?
Gary Holmes, Mr. at Garific on Twitter, great friend of the show, wants to know, Gary, is all your typography your own custom fonts or vector lettering?
Probably 99%, yeah. I think some of my older fonts were just bastardizations of fonts that I had. I just went in there and make the grunge version of it, and those are the ones I get away for free. It's just, I create shapes in Illustrator, and I just start tweaking out from there. I mean, occasionally I'll use, like, some base reference from, like, another font if just to have, like, a idea. Like, I think there's, like, some that people, like, said, that's very Mike Ginesh. I'm like, well, of course, I looked at his lettering because he didn't invent the style, but in the same token, I was just trying to see what the structures were and then just making sure it didn't look similar by any means, because that's the last thing I want to do is rip somebody off. So, I mean, it was just an exploration. But I would say, yeah, 99% of them are probably just shapes in Illustrator that, like, oh, that's right, let's make a font.
So it seems like, you know, tech is definitely a big part of your process, and, you know, you're pretty, you've got it figured out how you're going to navigate through a project. Talk about a time that tech got in the way or prevented you from creating the image that you had in your head.
What do you mean by tech or tech?
Tech, you know, the computer itself, or the input device, or the way that a program is set up to create an image.
Oh, yeah, Adobe Illustrator, honestly, it's like, I hate Adobe right now. It's like, one, they're making stuff almost too simplistic. I'm pretty sure they haven't, or they've been creating a button where it's like, click this and design your own piece right now, you know? But it's like with the advent of like Live Trace, and then every new issue, they always come out with like glitches and the thing, like Pathfinder. It's like, seriously, you had it right in 9. Why is it like getting worse and worse and worse? And so it's like, you start seeing all these like little functionalities. It gets really annoying. You have to kind of work around it. Like, honestly, I still use CS3 and I hate CS3 just because when you do your expanded path, you get these like little funky lines. I'm like, what the hell? Seriously. But, you know, I just learned to deal with it just, you know, for time. But usually what happens instead of the tech, it's usually the client. And I mean, not to talk bad about clients, is that you'll get a client that comes to you and is like, yeah, man, we want this style. And then when you look through the creative brief, you're like, that looks nothing like what I'm capable of providing. Then they get all mad. It's like, well, we should be able to do this. I'm like, no, it's like, if you actually took 2 seconds to look at my site, you kind of get a gist of what I'm capable of. And so usually it's not the tech so much, it's the actual people feeding you work, because they have this idea. I remember one time, it was a while back, I had this client come and say, like, hey man, it's like a pretty big client. They're like, yeah man, we want to look like Mike Chen. I'm like, hire Mike Chen. Well, okay, well, what about more of a Jim Phillips style? I'm like, why don't you contact Jim Phillips? Like, why are you contacting me? And it's like, and so to me, at the end of the day, it's just, you start dealing with that, and it becomes very, very awkward, and usually clients like that is, I'm not interested. It's like, just contact the guy, because the last thing I want to do is like Signal Noise, they come in and say, like, yeah man, we want something like Signal Noise. I'm like, well, of course I'm gonna rip him off. I mean, he's awesome, so I mean, he won't care. Joking.
We're gonna take one more video question, and then we're gonna do the segment where we turn the tables and you ask a question of the audience, Josh. So get ready for that in a second. But I got warned that there might be a little bit of lag on this video call, so we're gonna try it out real quick. And this caller's name is CAE Pinna, broadcast call. So let's try it out.
Hey,
how you doing?
Hi.
What's your name?
Hey, fine. Kae Pena. It's not from English.
Oh, hi. Nice to meet you. What's
your question? Yeah, that's right. Oh, I'd like to ask if... Oh, no, no. No, I'm not a stalker. I'd like to ask whether freelance jobs is better than a fixed job. You know, how is freelance better than a fixed job, or if a fixed job is better than a freelance? You get it?
Yeah, no, it's a great question, and I actually get this quite a bit. When it comes to freelance, that's kind of like a that's your last step before you really do anything else. I mean, it's really good during college just to get some portfolio built, projects built around there, and usually it's just you know, help out friends and local companies. But honestly, it's like in this day and age, especially with healthcare benefits. I mean, I know that Congress is doing like some weird thing with the whole healthcare bill. You know, lucky Canadians. I mean, honestly, because they don't have to worry about it. But in the same token, it's like if your employer is covering those expenses and covering your cost of living and stuff like that, then yeah, a fixed job is going to be awesome. I mean, it might not be the day-to-day that you really like, but really if you're going to do freelance, just do it on the side for moonlighting and then try to make a name for yourself. And then when you are ready to actually break free and do full-time freelance, I mean, honestly, like what I did, I had like 3 months worth of income saved up. And I took the risk. It was time. It was just one of those things. And you, I think as a designer, you know, it's like either going to you either know you want to be independent and you've always known this, or you are one of those people that likes working around other people. Because, I mean, I hate to admit it, freelance for me is a very solidarity thing. It's like I'm seriously in my office by myself probably at least like 80% of the week. And, I mean, it's my friends are really just online friends. And so it's kind of nice for me to actually go out and like talk to people. But I do miss that camaraderie. And I also kind of miss having that fixed check coming in too. Because, I mean, there are times when clients don't pay their invoices on time, or all of a sudden they're like, oh, we have a net 90. You're like, net 90, really? And so you kind of have to formulate and structure yourself around that. So freelance, it's very scary. And that should be honestly one of those things where it's like only do it if you know you can do it. Don't just jump into it full time and think that you can do it. It's like you have to have confidence. And so I would say have a job, and even if you hate the job, still make those connections, because you never know what those connections are going to lead. Do your freelance on the side, try to promote your name as much as possible, and just do the best that you can do. And I mean, at the end of the day, it's like you're going to know, and once you know, then it's going to be easy from there. I don't know if that really technically answers the question.
Kai Pena, thank you for asking the question. Yeah. And just real quick, are you in the U.S. or are you
thank
somewhere
you.
Else?
Yeah, I'm in Brazil. Brazil?
Brazil, that's
Brazil.
Awesome. Very cool. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming in and asking the question.
Hey, email me, because I just got them doing a basketball jersey for the Brazilian team. It's awesome.
What's your email? Well, do you want to put your email address
hey,
out there?
You.
Well, no, just, you know what? You can contact me. It's like, you know my site. So drop me an email.
Cool. Thanks, Kai.
Oh, okay. Thank you a lot.
Oh, I cut him off a little short. Oops. Sorry. Thanks, buddy. All right. So now we're going to switch we're going to rotate the tables. Josh Smith, Hydro74, I want you to ask a question of the audience. You guys, the audience members, you can answer in the chat room, and we'll try to rattle off some of those really quick. But if you think your answer is really awesome, type it in as a question. We'll bring it up, and we'll show it on the page. So, Josh, what is your question for the audience tonight?
I technically don't really have a question for anybody. I guess my question is, if you want a free font, email me, and I'll send you one of your choice. So,
nice.
Can't beat that deal. So, if you want a free font, just type in yes. I mean, as far as like questions go, it's like, have I been awkward? If so, how awkward? And the best answer will get 5 free fonts.
They're saying you are the man in the chat room. That's huge. James White says 3.4. Is that out of 10, James? I think it's out of 10.
It's probably out of 10. Yes, very awkward. thank you.
No, man, you were awesome.
So
seriously, great conversation. It was just really great to put a face to the work, right? Because it's so often that we, you know, we're perusing the internet, we're perusing Abduzito, we see all these great artists, these great collections, and you kind of blow by it, right? You don't really pay respect to the person. There's a person behind that. There's a person that created that. There's a person that put the 10 hours into that illustration and making sure that that curve is exactly perfect and doesn't have the wrong bump, you know? And it's just cool to see someone sort of face-to-face. I know digitally we're not really face-to-face, but, you know, just to get that sort of personality. So, no, not awkward at all by any means. It was just awesome to get the time with you, man.
Ah, thank you. Yeah, that was my pleasure. And I mean, honestly, I mean, if you want to talk further, that's fine. But I mean, I have nothing going on. So,
You got lots of stuff going on, and it's fun to watch everything. So your website is hydro74.com, and on Twitter you're at hydro74. Are there any other things that like you're releasing or publishing soon that people should be looking for?
I would have to say the one big thing right now is in talks with my friend Adrian from Revolt Marketing. We're really long-term friends, and we're actually trying to set up a basis to have Revolt kind of handle a lot of my marketing and handle a lot of my more day-to-days as far as kind of get me up with a project manager, because I've been discovering a one-man show is not a very good one-man show. It's like I'm starting to need help. So trying to work with him on some stuff, and we're also trying to consider doing a Dirty South gallery tour, which basically is just a bunch of digital crap that I'll just like we paste up or do silkscreen prints on, but it's just basically just go around and you know, hit like Arkansas, Mississippi and Alabama and hopefully Georgia up in Atlanta, and just basically meet people, get our drink on, and try to see if we can get so drunk that we forget what happened the day before.
I just saw a bunch of people had put in text questions as their answer. Yes, pretty damn awkward. I wish you wouldn't put us in this position. This person is very mad. Clean sweep. I don't want a free fun.
Ass up.
I want a collaboration. So Matt Beemans, I think you should email him and get a hold of him. You can find his email on his website. Daniel Clatino just plainly says yes, and so does Matt Santorio. So thank you very much, people, for telling him that he's awkward. That was awkward for me. A couple of quick thank yous. Thank you to, I forgot to mention at the beginning of this, Symbolic, SMBOLIC.com. We are broadcasting from their offices in West Dundee right now. They're a very cool agency. Check out their website. They're at Symbolic on Twitter, SMBOLIC. Please subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. Just search for Design Chat and hit subscribe. That'd be awesome. That way, every time we upload a show, you download it automatically. The last thing is that next week we're talking to Nathan and Katie of 8-Hour Day. Check them out, 8hourday.com. I believe they're out of Portland, Oregon. I could be wrong on that, but very cool people nonetheless. And finally, thank you again to Josh. Thank you so much for coming on. It was great spending time with you.
Hey, and just one real quick thing too, and just because I know how crazy it is with the economy and with the recession right now, if there are seriously some designers out there who are struggling, like seriously, just email me, and it's like I'll hook you up with a bunch of fonts and a bunch of vector stuff, because honestly, it's like, you know, I think especially this time of year, if we have the ego where we're not willing to help one another out through these like rough times, then you know, I'll gladly supply those resources, and I hope that other people kind of spread the love as well. So like seriously, if you are like struggling, just hit me up, and it's like, trust me, I've been there. I know what it's like when you can't afford something and you really want it, and you would really do good on a project that you can make some money on before the first, you know. So hit me up.
Very, very gracious of you. That's an awesome message, and I hope that message gets amplified throughout the design community. So thanks again, buddy. We'll be talking to you soon.